Hello everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel. Today we are going to be looking at hardware that you need to start a home studio. Even if you are already into home studio thing, I want to take you through most important hardware that you need to be able to be successful running a home studio. Either you are producing yourself, you are recording and making your own music, or you are producing for others. Let's look into the things that you really need to run a good, successful home studio so you can be able to record or produce clean, good audio. Let's go into it. The first thing we are going to talk about is an audio interface. There are so many manufacturers of audio interfaces out there, and there are so many different types of audio interfaces. The one I have right here with me is called Audience ID14. You have Focusrite and other manufacturers as well. This is Audience ID14. It works both on Windows and on Mac, and it has two microphone preamps. This is where you connect your microphone into via an XLR cable, which means you can connect two microphones and record at the same time, or you record two artists at the same time, or one artist, you're recording the vocal of one artist and you connect a DI, an instrument, through this DI jack and you record another artist. Like I said earlier, this works both on Windows and on Mac. It has one headphone jack, so you can hear yourself whatever you are recording. You can hear yourself live while you are tracking. That's an audio interface. Moving on, I said you connect your microphone to your audio interface using XLR cable. This is an XLR cable. An XLR will connect your microphone to your audio interface. Please don't go too cheap on XLR cable. They are really important. You cannot afford to have a weak link in your channel, in your chain of production. You cannot. Make sure you don't go too cheap on XLR cable. So this is an XLR cable that will connect your microphone to your audio interface. Then the next thing we will look at is microphone, because we've said many times that you connect your microphone to your audio interface using an XLR cable. This is a condenser microphone. A condenser microphone is better for vocals. You can also use a dynamic microphone if your room is untreated. A condenser mic needs a little bit of treatment, even if you are going to use a reflection filter. This is an Aston Halo reflection filter that I use. I've got two of them. You need to treat your room a little bit, because this microphone, they require phantom power and they are very sensitive. The sensitivity could be good or bad. The sensitivity is good because you can record clean signal. You can record the low, they have a large frequency range that they cover. However, if you record close to where is the noise is coming, or you record in an untreated room, then you're going to run into a little bit of trouble, because your vocal will be bouncing up and down and they will be coming back into your microphone. So you need to treat your room a little bit. Please get a reflection filter while you are recording. Don't record too close to your computer, because when your computer is working hard, the fan inside your computer will start working and the noise is going to go into your recording, which could make it, you know, unusable. Don't record too close to your fridge. Make sure no one is using the kettle or the microwave oven. You need a quiet environment to record using microphones like this. Okay, while we're talking about microphones, I told you earlier that you need a reflection filter. Also, you need a pop filter. A pop filter is like this, and it stays in front of your mic. What a pop filter does is to reduce the explosives coming from your mouth. I mean about the P's, the B's, the S. So when you speak into, when you sing into this, it scatters it, so it doesn't go straight into your microphone, thereby it's reducing the effect of those P's and B's and the S's. You need a pop filter as well as a reflection filter. Both of them are very important. Please get one. Get one of a reflection filter and a pop filter if your room is not treated. If your room is properly treated, then you might not need a reflection filter. Moving on, you need an headphone. You need especially a closed back headphone. I have done a video looking at different types of headphones. Please look at my channel and you will find the video where I went through step by step and I explained the types of headphones and what you can use them for. This is a closed back headphone. You need to put this on and connect it to your audio interface. You connect it through the headphone jack here, so you'll be able to hear yourself live while you're recording. So if you are recording more than one person, then you need two headphones. Talking about recording more than one artist, if that's what you're going to do, then if you look at this audio interface, it has only one headphone jack. That means you need something to expand the only one headphone jack here. This one is called, is by Behringer. Okay, this is by Behringer. You need something like this. Why you can do this is because if you have two or three or four people that you want to record at the same time, they need to be able to hear themselves via the headphones that you are going to give to them. So what you can do is to get a jack cable like this, connect it to the input of this headphone splitter. This is an headphone splitter. Connect it to the headphone splitter and connect it to your audio interface. So this is how it's going to work. Headphone splitter, the input side of the headphone splitter, it goes into the only one headphone jack in your audio interface. There you'll be able to give them their own signal one by one. And they have a volume knob, independent volume knob. Okay, so this is how you connect this. Moving on, if you remember earlier, I talked about a DI and included DI in your audio interface. One thing you can do as well, if you want to get a better signal, is to get a separate and external DI box. There are so many DI boxes out there. I will show you the one I have. I have this Radial Pro D2, and I have this this is called RNDIS by Rupert Neve Design. May his gentle soul rest in perfect peace. This is made by Rupert Neve. This is an active DI box, and this is a passive DI box. The difference between an active and passive DI box is this passive DI box works on a transformer. There is a transformer inside this DI box. The better the transformer, the better quality of the audio you are going to get. Now, this is good for instruments that can reproduce, that can send, that can give you a loud signal, a strong signal, because it is a passive DI box. and it only uses transformer. So you need a strong signal to be able to get the best out of this audio, out of this DI box. Whereas in an active DI box, active DI box need phantom power. Some of them, they use battery. I prefer the one with the phantom power because I don't have to think about, is my battery fully charged? Is my battery okay? So this one uses phantom power. One thing this one is good for is good. It's good for all those instruments with low signal. Because of it does use a phantom power, you are able to get a stronger signal. When you connect it to this, you can turn it up. Because it has something they call a pre-amplifier inside it. So it's going to turn the signal up. Both of them are good. Okay, I will advise you to get one each. You don't have to. Think of what you are recording. If you are recording a keyboard, I will go for this passive. This is actually specifically made to record stereo piano. Really good. This one, I would say, is good for bass. Okay? So these are DI boxes. I prefer an external standalone DI boxes than what comes with the audio interface. You get a better signal using an external standalone DI box. Moving on, let's look at MIDI keyboard. This is a MIDI keyboard. A MIDI keyboard is used to trigger sound on your computer. When you connect this to your computer, you open your door, your DAW of your choice, and then you need something they call a virtual instrument. Using a virtual instrument, you'll be able to trigger sound using this MIDI keyboard. You connect this MIDI keyboard through either of these cables. Okay? Every time you buy a MIDI keyboard, these cables will come with it, so you don't have to worry. Okay? They connect to your computer via one of these cables. USB type A to type C. This is this one, or USB type A to type B. So you need to check which one you want to use. USB type A to type B will come with your MIDI keyboard. I bought this because, you know, Mac only comes with maybe type C kind of connections these days. So that's why I bought this type A to type C. Okay, so that's what you need to connect your MIDI keyboard into your computer and be able to trigger sound. You can also program beats using this MIDI keyboard. Very good, very important. Now, another thing that you need is this. This is an SSD drive, external hard drive. You need to stop recording and saving things on your computer, because if you continue to do that, it will slow down the performance of your computer, and your computer's fan will start kicking in all the time, which is going to cause trouble for you while you're recording, especially if you are recording yourself, which means you need to be closer to your computer. So make sure you don't load your computer with things that are unnecessary. Get an external SSD drive. This one is made by Samsung. There are so many of them out there. I trust this Samsung. This is Samsung T7. You can get T5, T7. I think they have T9 now. So this is really good by Samsung. Get an external SSD drive. Very good. Moving on, the only thing that we can look at is this. Okay, this is jack-to-jack cable, instrument cable. Instrument cable is used to connect a lot of things. You want to connect your bass guitar, you want to connect your electric guitar, this is what you are going to use. And also, if you want to connect an external DI box into your instrument, you need this. One goes here, and then this one goes into your instrument. The difference between this instrument cable and this, and when we're talking about quality, is that you can buy something relatively good, of relatively good quality when it comes to XLR cable, but when it comes to instrument cable, please buy the best. This is made by Mogami. You will hear the difference. You cannot get away with buying cheap instrument cable. Go all the way. This is made by Mogami instrument cable. Buy the best when it comes to instrument cable. You need it. Okay? So those are the things that are fundamental to setting up a home studio. Also, I haven't talked about monitors here because I have another video where I've talked about studio monitors. You need studio monitors as well, because you just, when you finish recording using your headphones, you should be able to play it back to yourself so that you can relax and listen to what you've recorded, and others, especially artists around you, can hear, instead of having to use your headphone all the time. But while you are recording, make sure your speakers are not loud or they are not turned on. You can turn them on, make sure you don't give them any volume, so you don't have a loop of sound going around, which is going to feed back into your microphone. Okay, thank you so much. If there's any suggestion that there's a topic you want me to treat, drop me a line there and I will look into it. Thank you so much for today. Take care. See you another time.